Big shout out to Bean Working Espresso down in Skyring Terrace, Newstead.
Best coffee in the game.
Best absolute coffee in the game. Hooking the Platform podcast and any listeners up with a 10% discount.
Shout out.
Shout out to Yolanda.
Yolanda.
That was a mouthful.
Their coffee's real fucking good. Get
Best
it.
Coffee in the game by far. Just opened up Skyring Terrace. You can order ahead and mention the Platform podcast for a 10% discount.
Platform Podcast with B-Bad and Brandon.
Welcome to the Platform Podcast, a very special tradie edition. I feel really like manly in this shirt, to be honest.
It's about manly time. Is it your first time wearing high-vis?
No.
Oh, that's why.
Really?
Yeah.
I was apprentice chippy for a bit.
You're right.
Yeah.
What happened?
I played rugby instead.
It was too hard, wasn't it?
Hit his thumb too many times. Yeah.
Probably. Yeah, so those two very deep, manly voices you just heard, the voice of two very strong and handsome lifters who are also, actually, you both work with each other too as well, don't you? Is this awkward?
Boss slave.
Yeah. Mr. Terry Sparkes and Brock Ridsdale. Welcome.
Thank you.
That's good. Now, Johnny.
Terry.
Brock.
21 words, who you are and what you do. We count all your words, all your sounds, including the farts. Go.
Family man. Builder, carpenter, Christian. All round strength sport enthusiast.
You have 11 to go.
No pressure. Use them up.
Sports fan?
13. No, you got 9 left.
Generally just help good people.
You have like 4. Or you can just leave it there.
I'll just leave it there.
Oh, there you go. You're 21. Well done.
B-Rock.
That's 5.
Have you been practicing for this, Brock?
No. Don't count those.
I forgot about that. I should have practiced.
I haven't practiced, pulls out a piece of paper.
Let's go a couple of words here.
Brock, this is your second time on the show. I thought you'd be a bit more relaxed.
1.2. I don't know, that other one wouldn't count because there's only 10 minutes. I think I boxed his bike in too.
No,
you did.
All right, B-Rock.
21 words.
Count them out.
Sounds.
Beat it up.
Yep. Brock, 110 kilo powerlifter, carpenter, 12 years, and that's it. That's
there
all I
is
got.
So much more to Brock than
it's
just
not,
that.
It's all hidden.
You're a ninja.
With origami paper stars.
Kung Fu man too.
Did you know that he does origami? Terry, as
no,
a boss?
I didn't. I found out he was a kung fu master last weekend when we were on the course.
In the lounge room of his house.
When he was instructing one of my mates for about 3 hours, at about 3 in the morning.
Yeah, so you guys had your pretty much annual half-year get-together?
Yeah, end of financial year. Golf day.
How was that?
It was pretty good, actually. Yeah. It was a good day.
Yeah, it was a great day. Yeah. It was pretty tame for us, usually. Like last time a golf buggy got rode off, so this time it didn't.
But that's sign of a good one.
Yeah.
They weren't selling any drinks or anything. I think because of the COVID, like, you know, the bar, you can't serve.
Oh, yeah.
They weren't selling any drinks. Heaps, so, yeah. They weren't selling drinks, but Brock goes, I've got 10 cc's in my bag. You're right.
And they were gone.
So good. Sick. Now, obviously, you guys have achieved a lot in, you know, the sport of powerlifting. So before we kind of get into the crux of, you know, the life of a tradie and powerlifting, because it's just, you both know how fucking hard it can be on the body. Give us a rundown of your, I guess, professional career as a powerlifter, starting with Brock.
Like comps? Like what's... Yeah.
How long have you been doing it, bro?
Be 4 or 5 years. I think since pretty much I've been with Brandon, so...
There's it could have been earlier, but someone injured themselves.
Yeah, but I think that was a novice comp.
No, it wasn't. It was Spring Cup.
Yeah, right.
So can you please tell the listeners how you hurt yourself and what you did?
I was doing a head spin. You know that breakdance thing? Yeah. Nice. So I was on my head.
What, in between squat, bench, and deadlift?
No, I think I just benched like pretty close to a PB or something.
This was in the gym.
It's just classic, man.
I was in the gym.
This is 4 weeks out from a meet.
Mm. Yeah. So, you know, just dicking around. Did like a head spin. Nailed it. It was perfect.
Mm.
Textbook. And then there was like these two little dogs. You know when you get real low, like dog, they just run up here, like real excited? Yeah, pumped. Knocked me over. Oh. And then just boom, broke my wrist. Like clean snapped it.
When was that?
2016.
Can you still head spin?
No.
Nah, I'm probably too.
Yeah, you just give shells.
Oh, I mean,
on the rubber.
Yeah, we got rubber. A couple of mats down. We'll spot you.
It was good. There's a video. I sent you that video.
Send us the video. We'll put it up in the in the YouTubes. But, but yeah. Anyways, after that.
Yeah, what? There's been like...
you did push ball.
Three.
Do you remember your numbers, your first states?
Shot? Oh, low. It was a sumo deadlift too, so I don't think those numbers count.
Easy.
Terry's like,
very true.
Very true.
I don't...
the manliest person said it, so it must be true.
I can't... Yeah, I can't remember. It'd be like...
230 squat.
Yeah, 220 deadlift, 230 squat. Bench was...
160.
Yeah, 55, 160.
Yeah.
It floated around there for like 2 years.
Mm.
And then just went boom. So it was...
Brock, you started taking a bit more serious in 2017 and even in 2018.
No more breakdancing, gave it up. And the totals.
Totals went up.
Yep.
Breakdancing went down.
Okay, well, since you're really, you know, awkward, I'm just going to interject real quickly before so we can move on to Terry. So since then, 2018 came third at Nationals with a 745 total. And then States 2019 went 755, took out the 100 kilo class in Queensland States. And national champion, GPC national champion in the 100 kilo class with an 800 kilo total with braids.
It's battle braids.
Yeah.
That was fucking sick.
Yeah, see? Yeah.
Exactly.
But, and then off the back of that, Pro Raw invite into the 110 kilo class. So quite a pretty like quick rise and absolutely got so much more potential in there.
Be good to see you next 12 months.
Fucking oath.
Post-COVID, when we can actually do
stuff. Well, you obviously that meet this year, what was your best lifts in that COVID GPC meet?
In March. So that was 320 squat, 200 bench.
Boom.
I don't think Lane got that. and then that last deadlift, 310. Yeah. Classic Lane.
Classic Lane. Now, Terry.
Yes.
Give us a rundown of your professional powerlifting career.
I don't think I had my first comp until 2014, and I think it was a States.
Really?
Yeah. I joined PTC Brisbane in 2012.
Yeah.
And I didn't really have an interest in doing a powerlifting comp at that stage. I wanted to hit some big numbers in the gym because they always had the board. Board. And you only had to do like a legal lift in the gym to get on the board. That's all I cared about at that time. I was more trying to get strong for athletics. For shot putting.
Oh, you're still shot putting at the time?
Yeah, I finished playing rugby league in 2009 because we had Maya. That was our first child. And so I thought, okay, I can't afford to get injured playing footy. You know, I was still on the tools sort of 50 hours a week then. So I thought, okay, I'll go do something else. I'm a competitive person, you know. So I went to the gym to get strong, obviously, and to facilitate the athletics. And then I think it was Polly, actually, when I was there before him, a good 2 years before him, but he came in one day and I told him I was going to put a thing on the board. He goes, it doesn't count unless you do it on the platform. I said, there's a platform right there, so I'm doing that. He goes, no, the competition platform. I said, okay. And I think it was a bench-only comp, my first one. And because I was doing a shake-out bench program. And then, yeah, I sort of just got in. And I did the first powerlifting comp. And, you know, I thought, well, that was pretty cool. Mm. And then the rest is history. I sort of gave. And the other thing, too, was it was getting a bit too hard doing throws training two or three times a week and trying to get squatting up, benching up, Olympic lifting up, all that sort of thing. So I gave the throwing away. It was just too time consuming. Oh, and so I
had ball powerlifting.
Yeah, so 2014, just sort of, you know, dipped my toes in and just started, kept going from there.
Do you remember your first total?
I think the first total was 720.
Oh.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure it was around 70. Oh, there was never one in the sixes, I don't think.
What was your body weight at the time, if you remember?
114.
Oh.
Yeah.
Little Terry.
Yeah.
Slender.
Yeah.
Terry.
Little Big Terry.
Little Big Terry.
Yeah, it was a 114. Jeez. And it was hard because I came straight in and the bench wasn't big. Like, I've been benching for 170 since I was 25, right? And which
what was your bench in the first comp? 170.
It would have been about 165-ish, something like that. And it's just that the squat and the dead weren't up there. And so I had to get that up, obviously. But I was competing as Josh Tate, who was benching like 230 at the time. And so, you know, he was just killing everyone at the time. So, and then, yeah, it just went up from there. And it wasn't until I got invited to Pro Raw in 2015. Mm-hmm. And it was a great comp, and did three pro roars. The second one was at the Arnold's, which was fantastic.
Pro Raw 8.
Yeah, it was awesome. Yeah, and then obviously did Pro Raw 9 as well. Did some Nats in between as well.
Yeah,
but the numbers were coming. I'm glad I stuck with it because the numbers kept climbing up. It's just the consistency and the persistence sort of had to stay there. Yeah. And after Pro Raw 9. I was just getting really beat up and work was picking up and we just had our third child. I was like, oh, I can't do this anymore. And then played half a season of footy and then...
I remember that.
Yeah.
Seeing the fucking truck just run over someone.
Yeah, it was good fun. Like, and I had all that extra body weight to throw around too. Like,
you must have murdered some people.
Oh, it was good fun. Like, I was 126 kilos when I was running around there.
There's a video clip, I think, Jace. I think there's a video clip on his Instagram of Terry just running over this bloke, and I was like, that poor cunt.
It was funny. I was talking about this last weekend, and I actually scored a really long try, which shouldn't have been able to happen because of my size. So I remember running. It was at least 50 metres. I remember running going, someone's going to tackle me soon. I said, just go as hard as you can. And I've seen the video since, and some guy has some pathetic dive at my ankles, like 10 metres out. And I thought it was because I was fast. I was like, yeah, I'm pretty fast. Must be these nice strong legs from squatting. And they're like, no, man, they just didn't want to tackle you.
That one guy's gone, on this grenade. But
I thought I had a bit of speed.
So since then, Pro Raw 9, you did GPC Nats last year.
Well, what happened was Valhalla got a bit quiet there for a bit. And the only lift is in the gym. The only lift is in the gym. Well, I was kind of retired, you know. And
you've retired too many times.
No, only twice. But, no, I was sort of half retired and Tish sort of asked me to do states. She's like, you want to do states? There's not many people from the gym doing states. I was like, no, not interested. And then she asked me a couple more times and I thought, you know what, I was in there training heavy anyway and so I did states. That was that.
2018.
Yeah. And that was cool because I only put together a 6-week prep. And I don't know, just having that time off, I had a good 6-7 months off. And I just played footy and I did jiu-jitsu in that time and didn't touch much heavy weights. And then just in 6 weeks, the strength came back and more. And won states overall as well.
Do you remember what you hit?
It was an 8.22 total.
Jeez, that's not bad.
There was a guy on the day before. I think his name was James O'Toole. But
Jimmy O'Toole?
Yeah. Well, he was on gloss. He was winning. Mm. And I had to pull.
He went close to 780 that comp.
Fuck. Yeah, well, I wasn't at my best, but I was getting strong quick again, and I had to pull 3:22
for the win.
For the win overall to beat James from the day before, and on the second deadlift, I was cooked. I ground it up to about here, just above my knees. You know, you sit there and just nothing's happening. Mm. And I was cooked, face was red. It was done. And then I don't know how, because Scott goes, oh, just have another crack at it. I was like, man, there's nothing left. I don't know how, but the last one, I just pulled it. And, one stays overall. And then went to Nats. Obviously, oh, that's right. I sort of said to myself, oh, you can't win states and then not do Nats. You know what I mean? It's pretty rude. It's pretty rude, like, to win states and not represent, obviously, Queensland and do, because you're not just representing yourself. Like, a lot of people think it's just me. It's only for me. There is a trophy there for the winning state. So, and then at Nats that year, you were there. I remember that. It was down at Frankston Arts Centre. And you were there last at,
yeah that's right. And that was the one that Brock came third at and had to pull for the win.
Oh well,
you were all on the same day. I remember
that was going to be
with the rainbow socks.
Oh, they were horrendous.
I was quite happy to leave it there again until I pulled for the win at Nats and
you won, right?
No, I was the second last lifter, and I pulled for the win and I pulled it and it was 8:75. And then one of Fuzzy's lifters came out and put another two and a half. David Chance, yeah.
Yes.
And just pulled a really good deadlift and pipped me by 2.5 kilos over the whole day. Yeah. And I was like, oh, that's a good day, you know. And I was like, man, 2.5 kilos, it sort of eats away at you after a couple of months.
Get a bit itch.
And then I had to lift again last year because of that. And I made sure I won it good and proper last year.
Yeah, you fucking did.
And where'd you go last year?
Not even 900.
Even 900.
Just an even. Just 900. An even.
Yeah, yeah.
And how much did you win by?
I think it was about 40 kilos.
Yeah.
Hey?
Yeah. From memory,
do you remember the breakdown?
It was a 350 squat, which I
you
stuffed
only took
that
two
up.
Attempts, hey?
Yeah, I stuffed it up totally because I did 350 in training, and it was a good lift in training. And I'm a big believer of, well, it's not just about being a big believer. Everyone should be a believer in this, but I've always been really good at peaking for the comp on the day. You see a lot of people not peaking properly, and I smoked 350 in training. I think it was a little tiny bit high, but the speed was there. And then I just remember on the day, I couldn't get my pin heights right. And I just remember unracking it, and it was getting hooked on the hooks. And so I kind of just rolled it up my traps a bit to get over the hooks, which is bad. And I just...
You have 350 on your back.
Yeah, well, I just went into the squat just terribly. I was too upright because I had the thing too far, and coming up, it just cooked me. And I probably thought I should have done about 365 that day.
Fuck.
And
800 pounds.
I thought I should have. Like, I thought it was there. Even when the 350 came off, I was like, yeah, this feels okay, but it's in the wrong position. Just, and then as you come down, it starts going like that. You're like, oh, man.
Just to let you know, Terry, there's still time.
Oh. Tell my knee that, mate. My knee's about 65 years old.
Well, now if I get close to 90,
it's only 1 year older than last year.
I'm going to just good. Give him shit until he does another one.
But the bench and the dead was spot on. And I was happy with the bench and the dead. But I believe I probably should have done about 9:15 that day. But anyway, can't complain about 900.
Still time.
Yeah. What was it like coming out to pull that deadlift knowing that was worth 900 total?
I knew I had it. Because I was a lot stronger than the year before. And the year before, I'd pulled 330.
Yeah,
330. And I was easily... I just knew I was a lot stronger. And I wasn't going to miss that. Like, no way.
That was fucking sick.
Yeah.
I remember being...
It was good having all you boys there slap me on the back and...
I love slapping you. It was a highlight.
Is that the one that's up on the wall, the photo?
Yeah, it is.
In Valhalla?
Yeah. Yeah, now you've earned a place in the walls of Valhalla.
Yeah.
So your camera's
on. And you're on the board.
You're on the board.
Yeah.
You're at the top of the board.
Oh, I think Nate Davison's still at the top.
Oh, you actually went for the pull to take him off the deadlift.
Yeah.
That's right.
There was two things. I tried to take him, because what I tried, my third Because I pulled 340 on my second, actually.
Mm. Mm. And then 355 was your third that you missed.
Yeah.
To out-pull Nate Davidson on the board.
Yeah, which was yeah, it was.
And that would have taken Polly's record off the board.
Yeah. I reckon Polly would have been cheering when I missed that.
Well,
we'll just have to get it again then.
There's rumours that Polly's dropping back to the 140s to destroy that record so you can't reach it.
I think he'd be wasting his time. I'd be more worried about guys like him getting 1,000 later on. Like, I know.
He pointed to Brock, everyone.
Yeah. Oh, I did. Have you seen his calves, man?
Yeah, I know. But just a quick share, like, what would you say to Polly when he says he's going to just destroy that so you can never reach it? Say something funny.
I'm just trying to think, mate. He didn't say it when I was there. You got to say it to me.
Oh, yeah, there we go.
That's all I wanted.
Fucking bring it.
But going back to...
But he might be wasting his time. He'll drop back to 140. And then one of these other blokes like Kane or Lange is just going to pop up and smoke 1,000 while he's busy trying to muck around back here.
Oh, Polly, you heard it. Oh,
Derek. There's a lot. There's a lot coming up.
There is.
Really?
There is. And you put it perfectly, like, you know, the way the lifting's going now, like, Brock, we're looking at an 870 plus total coming into his next comp, you know, at 110 kegs.
I think he's easily got 900 done next year. Like, it's... He's got the right leverages, all that sort of thing. He's...
Hey, Brock, Terry just said it. You have to do it now.
I got it.
Yeah. Coach Terry.
901, just to pip him.
Yeah, he said that.
Well, if Brock goes 901, are you going to make a comeback?
No. I'll shake his hand.
And pull him in. I'm busy.
And then fire him.
Yeah. Yeah, nice, sorry, mate. We're going to have a work. We're a bit quiet.
Yeah. Don't worry about coming up Monday or Tuesday or the rest of the week.
One thing that you mentioned during all that, Terry, is you peak properly for a comp.
Yeah.
Now,
100%.
It's something that I've worked with Brock now for nearly 5 years, and we've had to develop along the way because your job is just so physical.
Yeah.
And that's one thing I definitely didn't take into account when I first started coaching Brock and wondering why he was just, you know, not getting what we had planned. But now we seem to have, like, keep it super... I don't want to say sub-max because we do push it, but we're not overreaching. We're not pushing the limits every single week. But you guys, like, you take 3 days off work leading to a comp and it's like you got a fucking brand new body.
Yeah. You forget, like, the amount of work we've done over the years. Like, I've been doing trade work for like nearly 20 years now, and I even remember it was tough when I first started, and all these grown men around you just look like alcoholics, man. Like, they're just old guys, but they're just strong, mate. They're strong and they can go all day, and when you first start, you don't have those sort of muscle fibers and things like that. You're just a normal bloke. Mm-hmm. But when you got to swing a hammer all day, or like a sledgehammer.
I think my first day, like, starting, I had to put all these joist hangers in, and there's like, I must have done about 300 nails, and I thought I'd pulled something, hurt my elbow, because it was sore for 2 weeks just from swinging the hammer, because you'd never swung it before, and then I've gone and done 300 nails in one day. Like, so 17-year-old, you're just like, your body doesn't know what the hell.
Some of those days we're doing flooring, and for 8 hours, you're swinging a sledgehammer. You know, it's eventually one day it just clicks and that shit becomes easier.
Mm.
And it's because you've just developed that work capacity.
Mm.
And that's when you, I've never been concerned in a powerlifting comp that I'm not ready, because we back up every day anyway.
Yeah.
And there is fatigue. There is, like, powerlifting fatigue is fatigue like no other. Like, you just...
Your central nervous system.
Oh, it is. And it does affect our work. Like, there's...
So we just had that conversation with Brock.
Well, yeah. It does. Like, especially January to April, when the humidity's around. Like, it's pretty bad. I had a pretty easy January to April this year because I was doing a bit of project management. Mm. And the boys were still working. Like, my chippy gang was still working on the tools. But I was sort of hovering between the site and the office a lot. But I didn't have the tool belt on much, but all the other years, you just, by 7 a.m., your shirt is drenched.
Yeah.
You can't drink enough water. You can drink 8 litres and it just does nothing. It just comes straight back out. And then you got to do that all day, and then somehow get to the gym. You've got to go home. I try to shut my eyes for 10 minutes.
I do that while I'm driving.
Yeah.
You leave work and you're nodding off at the red lights. Yeah. You're like, oh man,
yeah.
Get the pre-workout. Got to go squat.
Yeah. Yeah, but there's some tough years, like, especially when I was building a base from about 2013 to 2015, 16. I was doing a bit of volume. Mm. And that was tough. That was really tough. And that's when I thought, man, I can't keep doing this. Like, I've got to find a different way to train.
Mm.
And I did, luckily. But I think tradesmen can sort of back off the volume a bit and still get strong.
Mm.
You know, rather than doing 4.6s or 5.5s, I think we can get away with doing a couple of, maybe one or two sets and then making up for that.
Top set Terry method.
Yeah.
Oh, here we go.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
It's out. Exclusive.
Here's the secret, guys.
Yeah, I think you're getting enough work capacity 5 days a week at work. Mm. You've got that work capacity. That stimulation, you only need a little bit more stimulation to get stronger,
mm.
if that makes sense.
Because that's something we've implemented with you, Brock, and we've had a good response is either not doing as many reps or just doing a couple of top sets. And
well, you're lifting all day. Like
you sent me a video the other day of you...
That frame.
Doing the framing. Yeah. And I was like, holy fuck.
Yeah. Well, 9 hours a day, every day, for the last, how long have we been there? 2 months?
Yeah, well, that's stick framing. Like, we're building the frames, mm. and you're bending over a lot. That's
but you got beams, like...
Brock's caption was, my back.
But you're lifting beams. Like, you pick a beam up. It takes three people to lift it, and you lift that to your shoulder, and then you've got to walk up a ladder with it, and then hang onto it up above your head while somebody else screws it in. Mm. Like, and then you come and bench, and you wonder why one shoulder's fried,
mm.
and the bar's swinging to one side.
And sometimes if things aren't going right, you've got to hold that thing out there.
Yeah.
For a while.
And there's a lot of screaming and swearing.
Yeah,
get the clamp, you motherfucker!
Yeah. So do you guys auto-regulate or you're training a little bit for the week, though? So, like, if you rock up and you're like, fuck, I've been hanging, whatever you call those things, and it's bench night, are you going to dial it back a little bit and listen to the body? Or
What I always did...
No, see, I just didn't do it.
I think people always thought I was bragging when I said I never had a coach. And I wasn't bragging. It was just I never wanted to let a coach down because... Mm. If I had a really long day sometimes and I had a 6 o'clock appointment with Brando or something, I wouldn't make it, you know, just because the job's like that. Or if I got a heat stroke or something, I'm gonna ring up and say, man, probably not tonight. Mind you, there were times I did have heat stroke and I did come in and throw up and things like that and kept training. But that was only if there was a comp in sight, you know. There was other times you go, oh, you know. So it's just about picking your days, really, I think.
And I think you both, like, obviously working with Brock for so long, speaking from that kind of experience, but even now, you know, training out, coaching out of Valhalla for the last, how long? Nearly 2 years.
Mm.
2 years watching yourself, Terry, like, you're both really good now at saying, nah, that's it, no more.
Just get lazy.
You got to think about the next day, too.
Yeah.
What you got going on the next day?
Because I can put in 100%. You got to juggle it because it's like, do I give Brandon 100% and then the next day when I'm cooked, give Terry 20% at work? Or you try and find if I dial it back to 80%, then I'm also 80% for Terry because it's like, it work-wise, like my productivity. Because like looking for, like prepping for pro roll, I was like, oh man, it was so cooked because you had the heat too. Like you drink 12 litres of water and I wouldn't piss the entire day.
Yeah.
Like that's how much that's how much you just...
And that site we were on was a hot site.
Yeah, no wind is in a bit of a like...
There was a couple of days I sent him home because he was just... Like he actually asked me one day, I'm like, I'm crook, mate. I was like, yeah, go. Like he was...
You see, that's really good in Brock's circumstance as quite a high level lifter, having a boss with that experience and that knowledge and just that... Yeah, man, I've been there. Fucking get home.
Yeah.
Mate, to be honest with you, that's me being a little bit soft because there's some guys around that you work for. Like, tradesmen are hard people, mate. And me and him are kind of new age sort of tradesmen. Some of the older school guys, mate, they will just work, mate. They hardly even eat. Like, they won't eat breakfast unless work all day.
And or if breakfast is like a smoke and a can of Coke.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah, mate. And like like I was saying, you develop...
Trady nutrition.
Well, you develop... I've never really had to go into the gym and roll out and before I... If something's sore, I'll roll it out. But and do these big fancy warm-ups because there's two things we've... All day we've been working. We've been using most of our muscles all day. And because of our job, a lot of the weaknesses you get through life or lifting with, just say, an office worker, we sort of don't have. We use all our muscles a lot. Mm. And because of that, you know, we can get away with a few less things.
Mm. Yeah.
To achieve a little bit more. We, at our work party last weekend, we had the fire out in the backyard and the boys were on the piss. And they found all my Highland Games implements. So they just started throwing them. He was the worst. He just couldn't stop.
Yeah.
But you got
trained. Who threw the furthest?
Well, me.
Yeah.
But
I got told that about four times from Brock on that Monday. Like, fucking Terry.
Man, oh, yeah. I was getting real fired up. I was like, I got to throw this motherfucker at me.
You were sore out next day, right?
Yeah, I was, hey. My arm.
But we picked. But the boys, these are tradesmen, right? And none of these guys go to the gym. Mm. They just work and drink piss, right? But they were throwing these things a long way.
Mm.
Like, it's because they're strong boys, mate. Like, that's their life, is swinging hammers, carrying timber, carrying heavy things.
It's just something that's physical, yeah. As coaches, you know, and trainers out there that are, you know, they're running people like tradies through these sessions and they're not taking that into account. I know I didn't.
I personally don't. Like, I'm not qualified to say so, but in my opinion, I personally don't think. Like, you've got to tailor-make your program to each and every person, but I don't think they need that sort of stimulation because the trade, for me personally, I didn't need to be doing eight sets. You know, I kind of found that was actually going the other way.
Mm-hmm.
It was just cooking me more and just stuffing everything up. Whereas finding something, and I think I sort of pulled that more out of the Lily Bridge method.
Yep.
I tried that once and there's no volume, mate. It was pretty much your deadlift heavy
every fortnight.
And
squat
and
heavy every fortnight.
Yeah, squat in between heavy. But you'd still do the both lifts on the day, but one's heavy and one's light.
Mm.
I gave that a go, and I remember talking to Chad Wesley-Smith, and he's like, look, there's not enough volume in there. And I kind of agree with him because I sort of bastardised the Lily Bridge program. I just put a little bit more in. So you do a top set, but then I'd back off and I think the Lilybridge boys would do a top set and then they'd just do accessory work like you wouldn't believe, like bodybuilding accessory work.
They're crazy.
Whereas I might do a top set, but then back to weight, right? Let's say I'll do a top set on squats at 250 and hit as many reps as I can. and then come back to, say, 140 and then do some sets of pauses or something like that to get a bit more stimulation.
Top set Terry method.
Yeah, I was born that day.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's just a bastardised Lily Bitch program, really.
It's the top set Terry method.
It is now.
It's an ebook. 900.
The ebook's coming out.
Yeah, you do one 995. Be able to pick that up, yeah.
Yeah.
Fucking hell. That's insane. But now, you're both also, like, I've always said this, I don't believe powerlifters are just pure athletes. Like, we're just really strong. We'll hope to be really strong.
Yeah.
Whereas you both come from a very athletic background. Obviously, Terry, with your shot putting and your rugby league. Brock, as we found out, was like a national level swimmer.
Yeah. And a ninja.
And an origami folder.
Yeah, that's the top one.
Just another thing. Brock knows so many things that are just so fucking random.
Give us one, Brock.
Oh, you can't do it on the spot.
Put Brock on the spot, yeah. Manny. But how much did all that prior stuff you did, whether it be, you know, league or swimming for Brock, has carried over to what you do now in terms of your work capacity and everything?
Massive, mate. Like, especially for me, the biggest thing was track and field.
Mm.
Like, when I was at high school, I did little athletics too for 4 or 5 years from under sevens.
But you weren't so little.
Back then I was.
I don't know.
And then high school, I was little actually because I was a jumper.
Jumper?
Yeah, I was doing long jump, triple jump, all that sort of stuff. But three afternoons a week.
Johnny's eyes is like, wait, you were jumping?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Can you imagine how deep the hole in the sand would be now?
I was only about 84 kilos or something back then. But
wow.
Just 3 afternoons a week, jumping and sprinting and jumping and sprinting. And these are good coaches, you know. I was at a GPS school. Like, you have good coaches, and they're running you through it like big, like they're giving you a hiding. And you know, in hindsight, it was good for the lifting, but it's also bad. The reason his knee's got nothing left in it is because of jumping and sprinting on a tartan track. Mm. It's just hundreds and hundreds, like thousands of jumps over the years. Especially triple jumping. I don't know why I did that. And when you look back at it now, you're like, what the fuck did I do that for?
That'd fuck you up.
Oh, especially because you jump off your right and then land on your right on a hard surface. Mm. You do that like thousands and thousands of times. The meniscus in this one is pretty much nothing now. And then because of that, everything's out of line and played a bit of footy and there's arthritis there and that sort of stuff. And so, but yeah, to answer your question, like huge, mate. Just speed power, and it especially throws up in the throwing and the Highland Games, because you've like there's been strong, a lot of strong men have come over to Highland Games to have a go, like really strong men, guys who are as good as I think a couple of the Australian strongest men have had a crack, and didn't go so well because there's been strong, but there's also speed power, and that's where they've come undone a bit.
Well,
you know,
we had Tim O'Shea on recently, quoted you as one of the most freakiest throwers he's seen.
Because I went in the Highland Games.
And won it.
Oh, the first one we did was at Ipswich, and I come a close second. The funny thing was that Games, they were having I think it was me and another bloke from the Gold Coast, they were having to teach us how to do the things before the event. like, how many rotations can we do? And it was funny because...
Yeah. Just went in and had some fun.
Yeah, yeah. And actually, that dart broke an Australian record for the weight over bar.
After you learn how to
do it. So what do? I just throw it. Oh, yeah. What's the record?
Yeah, I'll take that. Yep.
No, it was good. Actually, we found out afterwards, it was the biggest thrown on Australian soil. It wasn't an Australian record because Matt Sanford, who was like the Ed Cohen of Highland Games, he's an Aussie as well. He threw one about that much bigger over in California. Mm-hmm. So there was just a bit of confusion because he did it overseas.
Yep.
But it's still an Australian record. So it was the biggest one thrown in Australia. And the weight over bar is hectic. Like it's a 25-kilo weight with a handle. It's like high jumping. You throw it over the bar and it keeps going up. You get three cracks at it. People just keep getting eliminated.
Fucking hell.
So you have to pick the height you want to go for? Is that how it works?
Yeah, you can pick a starting height. Yep. I think they don't muck around with anything below about 11 feet.
Yep.
Everything's in feet too, by the way.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah. Because the sport's like 700 years old, and they haven't changed anything. Like you don't shot put a shot put, like something so round. It's a rock that's misshaped.
And that they found in the garden the day before.
Yeah. And
clean that one up.
Yeah. And everything's just old school. Like one of the events is the sheaf. You've got a pitchfork and pretty much something that resembles a bale of hay, and you've got to throw it over the bar.
Sick.
Yeah.
The pitchfork.
Yeah, you got to have a pitchfork. Yeah.
And you got to drink whiskey as well, right?
Yeah, so you got to toast the caber. So before you do the caber toss, you're supposed to toast the caber, so you got to have a shot of whiskey.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's that. Do you know what that is?
Yeah, what's a caber?
That's that big pole, isn't
it? It's like a telephone pole, but you got to...
Oh, yeah.
You got to flip it or something,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. That's fucking cool.
Yeah. You put it over your back or forward?
It's forward.
You basically get underneath it like this and have it tucked into your shoulder. And obviously, you're just going to run with it and you've got to flip it end over end. It's not for distance. What counts is how straight it is after you've flipped it over. So you want to go 12 o'clock, which is straight.
Yeah.
And then they start going in minutes after that. And if no one can flip it on the day, they start going on angles. The one over in New Zealand we did, the Oceanic Championships, there was a guy there with a protractor going along.
Really?
Yeah, because no one flipped it that day. It was like, I think that cave was like, it was huge. It was like nearly 6 metres. It was massive. Fuck. Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to hit the ground and go completely over.
Wow.
Fuck. That's and this dude run around with a protractor.
Yeah, there's a guy going along. Yeah, it was cool. That was awesome that day. It was 10,000 people watching us.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And you won it.
Yeah, and then they gave me $1,500 cash. They pick you up in a Rolls Royce from the airport, give you bed and breakfast, feed you, everything like that.
That,
and then
that one they do in Scotland, that on that show, that I text you about.
Yeah.
Yeah, they got the Queen goes and watches it because it's like right where they're.
Oh yeah, the Braemar. Braemar gathering.
That's a massive one. Yeah. They got the whole royal family goes and watches it because it's tradition. Because there's so many. It's such an old.
I didn't realise it was that old.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's old and it's not too big in Australia, but you go to the US and obviously Scotland, England, those areas there. There's even Eastern Europe, like the Highland Games is quite big. They're pretty big, but especially in the US, like it's pretty big there. I don't know how to compare to say powerlifting with numbers, but it's pretty popular. It's so, yeah.
So back to the original for you, Brock. How did swimming translate into powerlifting for you? Because you got a work capacity like I really haven't seen.
Man, it's just, I don't know. I've just been like, I've never been able to not do a sport in terms of like, I can't just not have something to do. So like I did swimming and I did swimming for like 12 years. So obviously that has its own benefits in terms of like joints and, you know, your workload is done in a space where you don't have all the impacts that you would have playing footy.
Mm-hmm.
So injuries are none. You don't have injuries. Like, really.
I can't believe, like, you know, talking to Brock at work and things like that and asking him, because I'm getting my girls into, like, especially my oldest daughter into swimming at the moment, the work those guys did. Like, how many Ks a day would you swim before school?
Yeah, it was 10 in the morning, 10 in the afternoon.
What? 20 kilometres a day?
Yeah.
How long would that take?
Yeah, about an hour and a half.
Per session?
Yeah.
Fuck.
I think, 2 hours. I think I started, you jump in the pool at 5.
Yeah.
And I'd be out at 7.
Yep.
Mum or dad would pick me up, go have breakfast, then straight to school for 8
o'clock. Well, you cooked at school, like you want to fall asleep in the
classroom. Yeah, yeah. I had the best religion teacher. He was like, oh, because because it was a Catholic college, you have the brothers.
Yeah.
And who live at the school and stuff.
Yeah.
In the chapel and that. And they're, he's like, oh, I know how hard you train in the morning. You're up early, yeah. You just have a sleep. Yeah, you're right. Because you just doze off. Because Brother Pritchard was like the worst teacher. he's old and you just get him talking about some story and he just go and the next minute the bell's gone and your period's over.
Perfect.
So he's like, I don't mind if you doze off and you sleep because I know how hard you train, but just put a book open on your desk in case a teacher walks past. I'm like, thanks, brother. Or he'd just give me A's.
That's the best. And then you'd back up in the oven and do another 2 hours. Yeah,
but you'd smell like chlorine all day because it's in your pores. You have a shower, but you can't get it out. And then once you start sweating, it just comes out.
So were you swimming for a club?
Yeah.
And then for school?
Oh, I didn't train with school because they were crap. Well, like, because I went to all their swim training in grade 12 because I was a captain of swimming.
Yeah.
So I was like, I better go.
How were you as captain?
Oh, yeah. So they have these Friday afternoons you do the inter-school competitions. And then on the assembly the next week, you had to say like all the results. You know, this person won this age and that age and that. Anyway, so they got me because I was the captain for 2 weeks. That was it, then they kicked me. But I'm the worst public speaker. Like, it was like I have an oral and they say you're meant to get palm cards and I was just like, fuck that, A4 page. Didn't look up. This is grade 12. Like, great, didn't look up. Look, yep, just read the paper. So to get on the podium in front of the school of like 1,100, I just did not look up. And it was the most monotone. I was just reading.
Billy won the swimming meet in worse. The 100 meters.
So, but I, so they kicked me. They're doing that. They got the head of swimming chick to do it. But I figured I might as well go to all those sessions because I was the captain, you know.
Yeah.
You set the standard.
Yeah.
Show up to every session. And, but man, I was doing 10Ks. Normally, I went there, they did about 800 meters, start to finish.
Yeah,
and
right.
The last that's half an hour for was them diving in and then getting back out. And I was like, my warm-up, like before, you know how we'd my warm-up was 2Ks. You did like a 2K individual medley, which is so...
Five hundred of each stroke.
Five hundred of each stroke.
Fuck.
And here they got 800. They were done.
Total.
No wonder our swimming team sucked. But, you know. But, I mean, these are kids who don't swim. Like, I was saying to you the other day, you'd have, at the competition, you'd have 10 divisions.
Mm.
Division 1 was normally the club swimmer.
Mm.
Or, you know, Division 2 was, if you had another club swimmer, it was that person, or just the best person who could swim. And then from then on, it just, if you could make it to the other end without stopping, you're in. Because it's just, you know, it's not big enough.
How did you go at the school championships, like against Padger and that sort of stuff?
Yeah, that wasn't... It's funny. That just... For me, in Division 1, it was the same as any other competition for swimming, because they were the same guys. Mm. I'm in the same race with them. They're the same age as me.
Yeah.
So we're in the same
heats. I remember you telling me a story about you won a freestyle race all strokes in one.
Yeah, because if you do, because the swimmer, like those school ones, that they're not so big, they would only have 50 meter races, but then they would have one 100 meter race freestyle at the start, and then everything else was 50. But for freestyle, you can do any stroke. You just have to let the officials know prior, so that when you dive in and start doing something different, they're not like, whoa!
Why is that? Because the other strokes are slower?
Yeah, I suppose so. It's just a freestyle is just freestyle. Like,
I didn't actually know that. I actually thought freestyle was just like the fucking arm style, and that was called freestyle. But I think it genuinely means you can do any style. Is freestyle?
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know that.
Isn't it Australian crawl?
I didn't know that.
Isn't it Australian crawl?
What's that?
Freestyle.
Australian crawl?
Yeah.
That's a company?
No, that's a style of swimming, isn't it?
Style of swimming? Like doggy paddle?
No. I'm going to fucking Google it.
Yeah, all right.
Well, you tell the story.
But, so you can do any stroke. You could even do backstroke. So that's why you got to let them know, because you got to jump in the pool first so you can start in the water. But so I was like, I needed more training in a 50 meter pool, because I trained in 25 meter pool, so you got that extra turns, and you got to break that, otherwise in a race you end up getting to the 25 meter part mark and you start looking for a wall, and your body starts slowing down without you even realizing, because it's waiting for a turn. So you got to break that. So I was like, oh, I'll do butterfly, I need it, I got a comp coming up, I think it was nationals or states.
Australian crawl is a style of swimming known as the front style of swimming or the freestyle.
There you go.
So it's just freestyle with a different name.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I think Australian actually invented the freestyle.
Could be.
Yeah.
I really think we should Google just that a little before.
Bit. Yeah. A little swimming trivia for you.
I'll Google that now.
And, you won this comp.
I did. I did the 100 meters butterfly instead, and I won by half the pool.
Fuck.
It was pretty funny. But when you go to the inter school comp, that Div 1 is just. It's everyone. I would go to the, you know, the Sleeman Center at Chandler.
Yeah, yeah.
Every weekend, you'd have a comp there. Mm. It'd be a short course comp, which is 25 meter, or long course, 50 meter. And all the same people, all the time.
Yeah.
And so you go to the school, like, all those guys got to go to school somewhere. So if they're not GPS, they're AIC. So it's the same people.
It was an Australian. And it's called the Australian.
There you go. But, it's such a good sport, even just for a base, because it's just, like, in terms of your fitness level and your lung capacity and all of that, like...
I feel like you could just go all day.
Yeah. Well, I never ran. This is just from swimming fitness. I would never run, because I'm in a pool, but, you know, like, I never had time to do anything else. And then we had the school cross country, and out of my whole grade, I came second. against people who train cross country and do footy and everything else. And it was just because...
You swam?
Yeah, just general fitness level.
Is that where your calves come from?
Could be. Don't know.
Can we get a zoom in on those calves, please?
We'll have
Jay?
A calf...
just keep ours out of it, though.
Yeah, please.
I don't want to be competitive.
Yeah, I'm going to get mine away.
Yeah. Look at those things. They're just ginormous. That's the fucking flippers in themselves.
Melanie was actually teasing me about my calves 2 nights ago. She goes, your calves are getting smaller. I don't know how to take it, really, but...
Yeah, mate, you just cop it. I've been dealing with that for fucking... How old am I? 27 years. Still no calves.
They're not coming. If I haven't come now, man, they're not coming.
Susie said to me the other day, she's like, they're actually growing. I was like, no, they haven't. Really haven't, Susie.
She's trying to build you up.
She was. So what's on next for the cards with you guys in terms of... Powerlifting, obviously, Terry, your Highland Games focus now.
Yeah, so the New Zealand, the Horarata Highland Committee, I think it's called or something like that, they're going to go ahead with it in 7th of November.
Fuck yeah.
So I'm going to train for it, but I might get a bit disappointed because of what's happening around the world at the moment. So I'm going to train my ass off, and then they say, hey, you still can't come over. So I'll probably lock in a single lift, like I want to do a heavy max. Probably
deadlift comp December 13.
Literally, just what I said. I said capo deadlift only.
That's too far away.
No, it's not.
No, I need to do something around September.
There's a comp you can do then, and then you can do deadlift capo only.
Yeah, I mean, he's always doing that one.
Yeah, peak, huh? And then peak. And then peak again.
Well, since I've been training his joint, that's the only thing I could do in that COVID break was go to his place, and that was the only time I could lift heavy. So I think the squats, what's going to happen?
I think Johnny just created a squat-only division. At
October 17.
Yeah.
Squat. Problem.
No, September. Got to bring it.
Yeah, okay. September. There's a comp.
Is it?
Yeah, actually, September 6. What? Got one up in Maryborough, if you're interested.
What's that?
Another capo one.
Get the ball bus.
Ball bus.
Yeah.
Anyway, we'll get the house. Anyway, I want to max something out this year. Probably squat.
Deadlift.
Fucking deadlift!
Dude, you pulled 270 today beltless. That looked like you could have pulled 310.
Yeah, I'm pretty sore, eh, after that. No.
We haven't deadlifted in what, like, fucking 3 months?
Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, I think I pulled once since February. You know when you deadlift and you haven't deadlifted for so long that everything just feels like you've torn something? Yeah. And you just keep going. Anyway.
So you got to feel good tomorrow.
Yeah, I don't know. I was supposed to throw tomorrow, so I'll see how that goes.
Fuck, so Highland Games. Brock, what about yourself?
Probably the biggest one would be Pro Raw next year.
Ooh, yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know. Probably just something in between to fill in time. So just something to work towards. So you're not just endless
motions, absolutely,
kind of thing. Yeah. So, yeah, probably something deadlift or deadlift only with Johnny or push pull or something.
Yep.
And then,
all I heard was deadlift only.
Yeah. All right, deadlift only.
Locked in.
And then Pro Raw next year. Hopefully it's on. So, yeah.
Awesome.
What's the go with the comps coming up, like with crowds and that sort of thing?
Wouldn't have a clue.
I think it's looking favourable from what I see. I mean, from venue, actually, I don't know for a gym. With gym,
I think at the moment it falls back on the 4 people per
square metre. Yeah, yeah. So fours, big space. Yeah. The space will dictate how many people.
Because what's yours is at Brothers.
Yeah, we're in a
rugby
venue
club.
Yeah, and I think they can. Yeah. I think they're up to 100 people now per venue.
Yeah.
Hey, yeah. Good. Oh. Close.
I was not listening at all then.
You were asking about what the things would be for things, people-wise.
That literally made no sense. People would be things.
Terry knew exactly what I meant by that.
Yeah, sick. Man, with all these restrictions easing, I don't see why not, but it will just probably be limited.
Yeah, long as from Melbourne, no one from Melbourne gets into our state.
They don't exist anymore. No.
Our country.
Yeah, I saw that. I saw
country,
that.
Queensland.
They're locked for another month minimum.
Good, let's keep them out.
4 weeks.
We don't need them.
Yeah. Then they reassess it. So.
All right. Now, before we get into the 10 questions, favourite moment in lifting, both is?
Oh, in lifting.
Or professional sporting career?
Oh, man. There'd have to be like a... Because I've done so many sports, it'd have to be like a one of each.
Yeah,
we're winning a grand final with your mates playing footy is awesome because you party for 3 days afterwards, you know.
Oh, we've heard those stories.
Yeah, they're not for this party, those stories. So that's up there.
Yep.
Winning that Highland Games last year in New Zealand was unbelievable because I suppose I actually got a little bit emotional after that. I didn't have a teary or anything, but I was just like, man, because I was over there by myself. Mm. Tim O'Shea was over there, but it was just, I didn't expect that because there was a guy there. There's a few guys there who hadn't been beaten in a long, long, long time. And everything just fell into my lap that day. Like it was just, talking about peaking, I just had a good day in a different country. And it was awesome. They gave me $1,500 cash, big trophy, and all this stuff. It was just cool. And I could have, unfortunately, I had to go back to the Christchurch airport that night. But if I had stayed there, they would have fed piss into me all night. Like, because when you get to the Highland Games, they have, it's an event as well. It's not just the Highland Games, they actually have like a Celtic event. So there's Highland dancing. Usually have like a run. Like they actually had a run at the Colorado Highland Games last year. They had to run a mile, and these guys in a kilt. These guys, everything to the Highland Games is in a kilt.
You wearing undies or no undies?
I just wear skins. Hey. I'm glad I do because I've seen a couple of photos. Like when you throw the cable up and the whole thing comes up, you see the whole tackle if you know. And it's a bit cold over there too. Right. But. Yeah, so that was cool, and I think powerlifting wise would have been winning Nats. That was pretty satisfying. Even though I've been down, like going to pro Raw and Arnold's is awesome. You know, compete in front of that many people, and it's just such a hyped up atmosphere. The hysteria is massive. But I think I really prefer fed lifting. I like watching GPC comps. I've watched a couple of capo comps because there was a couple. I think there was one I watched. It was a live feed. I can't remember. It was probably last year sometime. But I just like the fed lifting because everything's the judging's just so much more consistent. And not that there's anything wrong with the other ones, but it's, I just prefer the fed lifting. So winning the nationals, because if you win an Australian championship, that means you're the Australian champion, right? That's pretty cool. You've got a trophy that, or a medal that says it, and no one can take that away from you. Even if people go, oh, but you know, such and such didn't compete, it doesn't matter. Like, there's only one nationals.
You're the best on the day.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. So that was me in powerlifting last year's Nats getting a 900.
Fuck yeah.
Done.
Brocky? You've had time to think, bro.
Yeah. But there's a lot of like first time, you know. Yeah. But I don't know. Probably the first like 300 deadlift. That's pretty cool.
That was pretty special.
Yeah. Because it's just like, I think you were like, let's go, where do you want to go?
Oh, that was States last year.
Yeah, where do you want to go? 290, you know?
I remember because you didn't pull anything above like 275, 280. And this is going back to this whole fucking conversation about peaking properly. Takes 3 days off work, looks like a new man. And I'm like, just put 300 on there.
Yeah, and we're like, fuck yeah, just do it. Yeah. Boom.
And then it just came up easy and I was like, the fuck?
Damn.
That's probably.
That's fucking awesome, man.
But
all right, you guys strap yourself.
Are you ready?
10.
What are we gonna do, Brock Terry? Like, just to put Brock on the spot.
Our next guest. Oh, Katie can hear him. The earmuffs. Oh. You can't listen.
No, you're okay. No, you'll be able to prepare. Maybe we'll change the questions.
Oh.
Ready, ask Brock? Them in a different order.
Yeah.
And then kind of
Brock, biggest lesson.
How to swim.
Yeah.
Are we going?
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Biggest lesson.
Like biggest life lesson.
Anything. Whatever. It's so broad.
It's very open to interpretation.
Man, that's a tough one. It is very broad, isn't it? work hard.
Yes.
Yeah.
Brock, if you could live underwater, would you?
I lived underwater for like 12 years. Yeah, I would. Actually, I
like the
water.
You don't have to stay there. You can just live underwater.
I like the water way, like... I'll have a 45-minute shower. I'll just stand there because it's just like water. Or the pool, you just float there. Yeah, so definitely, yeah.
Terry, would you like to live underwater?
Oh, maybe like with SpongeBob and his community. Yeah, maybe. That's pretty cool, eh?
I'll do probably that. Take a few things and that'll happen.
No, you know the crusty... The Krabby Patties?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll just smash a few of those.
Brock, what's your biggest challenge?
I don't like confrontation, so that's probably the biggest one for me because it shuts me down all the time. And I was
just responding to someone
to strange questions.
Buying clothes and be like, yeah, you too.
Anxiety. Put it to that,
Mr. Terry.
What was the question?
What's your biggest challenge?
Time management, finding time to do things. Yeah,
this is probably a very big question, and I feel like too many people get it wrong. Is cereal a soup?
Nah.
It's wrong.
It's not. It's definitely not a soup. I agree with you.
When you think about it, Terry, you'll get it.
Nah, because you got to cook soup.
Do you? You've never had a cold soup?
Yeah, but it's been heat cooked already.
Was it?
Yeah. Well, I'm going to say it's not.
Okay.
I'm also.
Is that a tear?
It's a little one.
Is that tear soup or is it tear?
Yeah. If it landed in a bowl, make it soup. What conspiracy theory do you think is real?
Like UFOs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, well, that probably came out. Didn't it come out?
I don't know. I don't know.
US put something out? Anyway.
It's real. Okay.
Yeah.
I'll probably agree with that one. Yeah.
What's one of your rules, Brooke?
Beat Lang. That's it. It's a rule to live by, really, in life and in lifting.
Yes.
Yeah.
Shit out of Andrew Lang.
Fuck, it's a tough question. I've got a lot of rules. I've got a lot of rules.
Stay off your phone at work. make sure you rock up to work on time.
They're oh, bullshit.
There are any rules for you, cunt. yeah, I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, I got nothing, mate. Sorry.
Brock, have you or would you join a cult?
If they had like a free buffet, yeah. I'd be signing up. Yeah.
You're in.
Yeah, yeah. Nah. Generally, nah. Nah, I wouldn't join.
No cult.
Free buffet in your swag.
Yeah.
Damn.
Twist my arm here, man. But I will support in, Satan.
I thought the Wednesday lunchtime squat crew was a cult.
Yeah, it fucking is.
Well, yes.
Oh, Brock hasn't been there.
Yes, I would.
Brock, how many chickens is it going to take to kill an elephant?
How many chickens?
Yeah.
Probably just one chicken. Those things are savage, man. They'll run at you. Elephant just doesn't know what the hell's going on. It'll just come up and peck its eye and it's down.
It's fucked. Elephant's fucked.
I'll probably say one. Can elephant get salmonella poisoning?
Oh.
You're going the slow method.
Sacrifice. Chicken sacrifice.
I'll say yes.
Yeah.
One.
If life is a video game, what cheat code do you want, Brock?
Infinite lives.
Yes.
Yeah, boom. Can't die.
What cheat code do you want?
Work on this anxiety thing. Take a few hundred years.
See, I'm pretty old school, mate. When I used to play video games, like, it was...
It wasn't a cheat code.
There was no video games.
No, you remember Mortal Kombat had, fatality and things
the
like that?
He had was
something cool like that.
Yes.
Yeah, you rip people's hearts out and things like that. Yeah, something like that.
Yes. Brooke, you've just been arrested. What do your family and friends assume you've been arrested for?
Drinking. Oh, yeah, something like that.
Public indecency.
Failure to leave a licensed premises.
What are they? Public nuisance for sure. No doubt about it.
That's the 10 questions.
Yeah.
Well done. That's it.
Yeah.
All right. For the people, where can they find you? Next social medias.
Yeah. Instagram.
What's your Instagram handle, Brock?
I don't know. Piggy Smalls _
No, it's Piggy _ Smalls.
Yeah, I don't know what it is.
Why is it Piggy Smalls?
Because it's like Biggie Smalls, except I'm big because I eat 7,000 calories.
Do you remember we were pissed the other night? I told you everyone thought you were Piggy Smalls because you had piggy tails at Manette's last year.
Yeah.
No, that's not the reason. It's because I eat a lot.
And the braids.
I said, you probably need to tell a few people that.
Well,
now
you've heard it.
And Terry, where can people find you?
Little Terry. I don't even know if there's an underscore or not.
I've heard that people thought your name was Little Terry because you got a small penis.
Honey, that's only because I told them that myself.
All right then.
No, but it's a triple T, not a double T. Some other person took the double T.
Fuck. In little, that is.
Yeah.
Bet they don't total 900.
No, they should give it to me.
Yeah, fuck, I don't think they should.
Rip their heart out too.
Yeah, with his fucking cheat code.
Oh, legends, thank you so much for joining us, giving us your time on this Saturday afternoon, and we'll have to definitely get you both back on after, obviously, Highland Games and Brock does Pro Raw, and see how you go.
Deadlift comp.
We're all doing it.
Yep.
Are you doing
Debrief.
It?
Debrief.
If I can make it happen.
Oh, we're all doing it.
Make sure there's some beers next time, mate. Brianna.
Hey, oh, beers, mate.
Trigger.
Thank you, lads. We'll, Johnny, you get to do the 3, 2, 1. Johnny, I can smell that over here.
It was good, hey?
Yeah,
pretty good. Can we just let them rip through that podcast?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
good.
You be you, bro.